today. Amen. God bless you. There is a word from the Lord, and Christopher, you can turn this mic down just a little bit. There is a word from the Lord coming from Acts chapter 16. You've heard the entire reading, but I would like for you to focus your spiritual telescopes right there on verse number 26. And it simply says these words. Suddenly there was an earthquake so violent that the foundation of the prison was shaken. And immediately all the doors were open and everyone's chains were unfastened. And for the time that is mine, for the time that is mine, for the time that is mine, I would like to tag, keep on going, this text with the subject title, Break Every Chain. Look at your neighbor and say, break every chain. Amen. Break every chain. Break every chain. Amen. Break every chain. Break every chain. One of my favorite movies is called The Shawshank Redemption. Yes, and if anyone who has seen that movie, remember that Morgan Freeman plays a character by the name of Red. And at Red's parole hearing, he sits across the desk of a young man in hopes of explaining why he should be released. Now check out what the parole officer asks Red. Have you found some type of rehabilitation since you've been here? And Red responds, I'm not quite sure if I found rehabilitation. But what I can tell you is that if I could speak to that young man, I would tell him he should have done some things differently. If I could speak to that young man, I would tell him about the mistakes he had made. But that young man now is dead, and all that is left is this old man. I come to tell you that at that movie, Red was looking to escape his reality of being in prison. And he had been there so long until being chained and being in prison became a way of life. And I don't know if you know this or not, but you can be incarcerated in your mind for so long until dysfunction will become normal. Most of our lives, many of us know what it means to come from a dysfunctional background. Well, dysfunctional has become normal. So wrong has become right, and right has become wrong. And can I tell you one thing, that when it talks about breaking the chains, when it talks about breaking the chains, it's talking about being in bondage. It's being a slave, being unable to control your life. Is there anybody here who understands what it's like to be at a place in your life where you really want to break loose, where you really want to get out, but you can't get out because you feel like you shut down and locked in the same circumstances? That's what Maya Angelou meant when she said, I now know why the caged birds sing. Have you been there? And can I tell you that when we look at our society, when we look at our society, we look at our society, that we need to know that knowledge is power. Look at your neighbor and say, knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. You got to understand that knowledge, going back, son, knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. Knowledge is power. The Bible says that our people are failing, our people are destroyed because of a lack of knowledge. And when we look at what's going on in our country, what has happened in our government, where we have a government that's so concerned about not providing health care to folk who need health care, they're more concerned about life before death than they are about life after death. We have a generation that has lost knowledge. When we look at in our black communities, that black men compose 13% of the black people compose 13% of the American population, but 40 to 70% in the prison population, we're perishing because of a lack of knowledge. When we look at the fact that most runaways are running away because they are in families that men have abandoned. We've been destroyed because of a lack of knowledge. But we have more black men in prisons than we do in college. Something is wrong. Slap your neighbor, high five, and say something is wrong. Something is wrong. Something is wrong. Something is wrong. And when we look at this text, when we look at this text, we find Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas. Paul and Silas. Paul had an idea of where he wanted to go, but because of circumstances and God's providence, he found himself in a place, Macedonia, in a place called Philippi, a little outpost of Macedonia. And if you know anything about Philippi, Philippi was not Rome, but culturally, it was the intellectual place where you wanted to go. You do remember that Paul started a church in Philippi, and that was the church that was known for its love. And we find Paul right here in Philippi. And while we find him there, he comes upon a place where he meets a lady by the name of Lydia. Before we get to the text, I'm going to talk about Lydia. He meets Lydia, and he went on, and then she gets baptized. And while they're on the road, he meets another group of people, and then he runs into this lady who's running around crying out, "These are the men of God. These are the men of God. They are the prophets of God." The lady sounded like she was crazy. She knew what she was talking about because, number one, she had a gift of being able to see into people's lives. She was able to prophesy. But the problem with her prophecy was that it was counterfeit when juxtaposed to Paul's prophetic word. And so here they are, and Paul gives us three things about knowledge you need to know in order to break the chains. The first thing he lets us know, check this out, y'all. The first thing he lets us know is that your power is in your pain. Look at your neighbor and say, "My power is in pain. I got some power in a pain here." Yeah, Paul is talking to a lady who has some power, but at the same time, she's in pain, and because she's in pain, she doesn't really realize her power. And so Paul meets her, and immediately he casts out the demon that's in her life. And after he casts out the demon, y'all, the folk in town come, the people who are pimping her come and have him thrown in jail. They lie on him, they talk about him, and here he is in jail. They beat him all night long, they called him all kinds of things, and here he is in jail in pain. And you got to understand that some of your greatest ministry will come when you've got to go through your greatest trial. Some of your greatest words, some of your greatest work, some of the greatest thing that God has for you will come in the midst of going through your pain. Some of y'all would have never come to Christ if you had not had to go through some trouble. You might have never given up drinking or smoking if you had not gone through something. If mama had not died, you might have never known about the power of God. And the first thing Paul lets us know, that there is some power in my pain. And while they're in jail, while they've been beaten up, the text says that Paul is experiencing some pain. And unlike many of us, we try to take painkillers to relieve our pain. Some of us turn to drugs. Some of us turn to alcohol. But I want you to check out how Paul deals with the pain in order to break the chains. Yeah, the first thing Paul does is that he starts keeping patience, and he starts praying. Yeah, that's my next point right there. There's power in your prayers. Amen. There's power in your prayers. You got to know that there is power in your prayers. Paul starts praying in the text. Now listen, when he prays, number one, on purpose. He has a purpose for his prayer, and not only he's praying on purpose, but he's praying with a desired result in mind. I come to tell somebody, just you coming down here praying alone will yield no result if you don't believe that prayer will change things. So many times we come to church Sunday after Sunday giving up dead prayers because we don't really expect God to move. But Paul in his text gets down with Silas and he prays in the midst of his pain. And not only does he pray, but he starts sending up some praise. And I don't know if you've ever been at a place in your life when you didn't know how God was going to deliver, how God was going to answer, but you knew that if you can get down on your knees, you knew that if you can only talk to the Lord, that God will do something great for you. I believe that when you learn that God will answer prayer. Is there anybody here who know God will answer prayer? Have you been at a place in your life where you really need God to show up and to show out and you didn't know how you're going to pay the next bill? You didn't know where the BG money was going to come from. You didn't know if you're going to get the food stamp. You didn't know how the children were going to come by and visit. You didn't know how it was going to work out, but you knew what your mama told you. If you just had a little talk with Jesus, I come to tell you that when you start talking to God, he has a way of showing up in the midst of your mess. When you start talking to God, he's able to take some mountains and put them down to level. Paul knew that there was power in his prayers. That's why the Bible says that the fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. The Bible says that when you're sick, you ought to call for the elders of the church to pray. Jesus said that my house shall be called the house of prayer. Did anybody come in here to pray? Why should you pray? Just a little talk with Jesus. Tell him all about your trouble. Hear your faintest cry and answer by and by. Feel a prayer with turning. Just a little talk. Anybody know a little talk with Jesus will make it all right? Did you talk to him this morning? Did you tell him thank you for waking me up? Yeah, when you pray, you ought not just come praying and asking and begging for God, but you ought to pray and say, Lord, I thank you for what you did for me. Thank you for waking me up this morning. Thank you for the food on my table. I might be driving a hoopty, but I'm thankful. Anybody here thankful? Yeah. The text says that Paul prayed, number one, when he prayed on purpose, and he prayed for results. So there's power in your prayer. There's power in your pain. But I got one more for you. I'm going to let you go. Not only, hold on, stay right there. Let's go back. I got to talk about this. Not long ago, I met a woman who could not get her car started. And we tried to figure out why the car wouldn't start. And what we found out was that acid had got on her battery terminals and it had stopped the connection between the battery and the terminal. And that's what happens when you stop praying. The acid builds up around the battery terminal. That's what happens when you stop coming to Bible class. That's what happens when you stop worshiping. That's what happens when you start gossiping and getting in stuff you ain't got no business getting into. Acid gets between the battery terminal and you lose connection. So what I had to do, y'all, I went and got me some soda, and I took the Pepsi and put it on the battery terminal. Can I tell you, as the soda started getting on the acid, it started eating up, and that's what happens every now and then when you get down on your knees and let the word of God get in you. All that stuff that stops your relationship with God, he eats it away. Is there anybody know that God can? There's power in your in your prayer, but not only should you know there's power in your prayer. Go on to the next one, Dad. I want you to know one last thing. There's power in God's presence. The text says that while they were praying, the text says that while they were singing, they had every reason to give up. They had every reason to throw in a towel. They had every reason to say that God's not going to show up. While they were praying and praising, guess what? God showed up. The text says that he showed up right at midnight. And I got to help you understand the importance and the significance of midnight. Yeah. Because some of us want to avoid midnight.
Yeah.
But can I tell you that midnight is just the time period between night and day?
Hey.
And I thank God for midnight because it was at midnight that God showed up.
Where?
Just before it got light outside. Just before the sun came out, God showed up. And I come by to tell somebody who's in the midst of darkness right now, don't you quit, don't you give up, because it's midnight. Is there anybody here who knows that God's going to show up? He may not come when you want him, but it's midnight. And the Bible says that just at midnight, just before the sun came up, right at midnight, they started praying and praising, and the jail started shaking. And I come to tell somebody here today that God's about to shake some stuff up in your life that's been stopping you from seeing and hearing from God. Look at somebody and say, he's here. Yeah, I don't know what you're going through right now. I don't know what you've been through in your life. But I come by to tell you that he's here. He's here in the midst of your darkness. He's here in the midst of your pain. He's here in the midst of your prayers. When you feel like giving up, when you feel like throwing in the towel, don't you stop right now. Because God is here. He may not come when you want him, but good God Almighty, he will be right on time. I know he's here. I know he's here because I can feel him in my hand. I know he's here because I can feel him in my feet. I know he's here because every now and then when I feel like all hope is gone, God will show up. He showed up right at midnight. Praying. The Bible says that the jail started shaking while they were praying. Paul looked down at his feet. The chains that had him bound, they came off his feet. Look at somebody and say, God's gonna break. God's gonna break every chain, everything. That's been. Is there one who wants to unite with us this morning? Amen. Is there one? Come on, brother. I see it in you. You ain't the only one. Come on down. Come on down, brother. Come on down, brother. Come on down, brother. I see it in you. You want to come. Amen. Is there another to this morning? God bless you. Is there another? Is there another? I know there's another. I know there's one more. God bless you, brother. God bless you. I know there's another, though. I know there's another. I know that God is calling others to come to serve here in the vineyard. Minister Fred, I want you to stay down here with me. I know there's another. And this is, you know what? I know we got to take up the offering. But you know, the offering don't trump the Spirit of God. And if you got to leave, I understand. Just leave your money in the plate. Amen. God will take care of the rest. We're not here just for money. We're here for a move of the Spirit of God. We're not here to make this church become a mega church. We're here to change lives. And if you don't stay here, that's fine. But we just want you to leave changed better than what you were when you came. My brother, I'm going to pray with you all. May be seated. We have Brother Alvin here this morning, who has just lost his mother. And I know the hurt of losing a mother. Turn around, Brother Alvin. Now, Brother Alvin is a big man, don't get me wrong. And we got our differences, but I understand how it is. And I have been there. And y'all know I usually preach most of the funerals here. But Brother Alvin has made a specific request, and we want to honor that for his mother. Amen. Amen. So we do pray for you, Brother Alvin, that we have no hard feelings for you. We love you with the love of Jesus. Amen. So would you please point up to Brother Alvin as we pray for him this morning? Dear God, we pray for Brother Alvin, Lord, as he prepares to celebrate his mother, God. Lord, we know that you understand what it feels to hurt. You lost your best friend. So God, we pray that you will comfort Alvin. Fill him with your presence so that he will see you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. That's okay, my brother. That's all right. God bless you. Amen. Let the church sing. Let the church sing. Let the church sing. Amen. Come on, give this brother a hug. Come on, brothers. Come on, y'all. Everybody sing. Everybody sing.
I love you forever.
Everybody.